All right. Well, good morning, everyone. People are still coming, dragging in Assembly of God time, I guess. It's kind of how it is. But welcome. Welcome if you're joining us online this morning. Good to see you there, here. Glad to have you. Wander on down some Sunday because we have a seat open for you. All right. Well, let's start out with prayer, and then I'll go through a few announcements here, some things that we need to talk about. So Lord, we just praise your name this morning. We come to you and give you all the glory and all the honor, Lord. This is your place. We're your people. And God, this morning, I pray that you would meet with us here in this place by your Spirit, God. Just move in our lives, move through our lives. We thank you, Lord. Bless your word. Bless our worship. Lord, we are just excited to be here in your presence, Lord. I pray that you would encourage us in that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, Randy and Nina are not here because their anniversary is on Tuesday, and they are out for the weekend on an anniversary trip, so happy anniversary and blessings to them. They've been married longer than I've been alive, so wow, that's something. And so have you. Your anniversary's coming up too. Have you been married longer than I've been alive? Probably not. I don't know. 50 years? 51 years? Oh, that's right, because we had your 50th. Well, no, I was around when you were married, so. All right. Anyway, enough of me. Let's talk about other people. Randy and Nina, blessings to them as they celebrate their 60-something anniversary. And Ashley Brown has a birthday on Saturday, so happy birthday to Ashley Brown. And Brown family, we hope that you're watching this morning. We miss you. So we have begun our Wednesday night classes. Our Wednesday night classes have begun, and so just like we have in the past couple of years, we found that starting with a meal is the best way to start, and so we are looking for help. My wife is kind of coordinating meals this year, and if you would like to help, sign up for a week, a month, that you can join with us and provide a simple meal, and if you want ideas or want to know what kids like, talk to my wife, and she'd be glad to steer you the right direction. But it's just been a real blessing to everyone who comes to start with a meal. Our missionary of the week this week is Tamara Henkes, and she is in Montenegro, and I contacted her, and she said that things are still locked down pretty good in Montenegro. She is able to get out a little bit, but not a lot because of all the restrictions. And not only that, so she's praying for, as she's still learning the language, her language skills, and also that she would continue to be able to reach out to people in her immediate neighborhood and people in her town, that she can establish some bridges with people and share Christ with them. But the other thing is that there is some unrest, and there has been unrest in Montenegro for quite a while. If you'll, I looked it all up when she told me what was going on, and that is the former Yugoslavia. And so there's a whole lot of different countries now that used to be Yugoslavia, and seems like all these people have not gotten along, and so it's still happening. So if you, while you pray this week, as we go through our prayer calendar and our readings, please remember Tamara Henkes and the country that she's serving in, that God would open doors and make a way, because hope is needed. I also have a friend in Germany, and he's just been really discouraged, and he does not know the Lord, so I'm trying to share Jesus with him, but he's very discouraged because Germany is just going crazy. It's almost like the 1930s again in Germany, the way things are going, so it's kind of scary out there. But, you know, our God still reigns. Amen? That's right. We don't have to worry. Today is National Campus Day, so Tom Bachman, our Oregon Youth Alive guy, has asked us to remember that and to pray. We are still working on our youth, trying to get everything rebuilt back, and we've spent some time talking to some folks who might be able to help us with that. But please be in prayer for our campuses, from kindergarten all the way up through high school, that there would be a witness on campus, that we would be able to, our kids who love Jesus and know Jesus would be able to share him with other kids, because they're allowed to do that. Sometimes people think that that's not allowed, but students are allowed to share with students. So we're just praying that God would make an inroad, more inroad into the campuses. Speaking of food, we're having a memorial service right here next Saturday for Kaylee Osgood, and we're expecting a ton of people. Hundreds of people. Well, I don't know hundreds of people, but 150 to 200 people, and there will be a meal after, and so we need to get together and help. So if you haven't already done so, please contact my wife and coordinate with her to provide some food for that gathering. Anything else? Okay, so salads and desserts is what we're looking for, okay? Yeah, that'll be easy. Huh? The memorial is at 1 o'clock right here, so. All right, also we are in need of prayer for a lot of people. Now, there have been a lot of people down, and we're still praying for them. There's been a lot of people who have been down and who have been who are back strong again, and God has touched them and healed them, and so we're rejoicing with them. But please be in prayer for all of those who you know of that are still suffering. Specifically, Ina and Dan, who sit back here, they have COVID, and they are really suffering right now. They're on some medication, so if you remember them this week, that would be wonderful. I told them that we would pray for them this morning as well. Also, our friend Phil Malcolm, missionary to Africa, is going through a really, really hard time right now with his cancer. He's changed his program, medications, new chemo, and he's really suffering right now. So please be in prayer. This is what I would call an urgent need. We always pray for our missionaries, but this is an urgent need. So please be in prayer. I put it on the prayer post. And if you, by any chance, you're part of Family Worship Center and you want to be on the prayer page, we list a lot of prayers there. A lot of stuff goes on there. And if you're not part of that and you'd like to be, please let us know. And we will see about getting you on the prayer page, because all the prayers we can get certainly help. So, but before we go to the Lord in worship, let's go ahead and pray for these needs specifically and other needs. Lord, again, we come to you with praise and worship. We come to you, Lord, acknowledging you, Lord Jesus, as our King and our Savior. And Father God, we thank you because you are our loving Father, our good, good Father, and we praise your name. And Lord, your people are suffering. Your people are in pain. Your people are sick. And Lord, we lift them up to you right now in the name of Jesus. We lift them up to you for prayer. God, that you would touch them, that you would see them, and that you would touch them, Lord, and lift them up out of their sick bed. For Ina and Danny, Lord, I just pray in Jesus' name that you would break this COVID in their bodies, Lord, that you would cast it out, and that, Lord, you would heal them in the name of Jesus, raise them up in strength again. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for my friend Phil, missionary to Africa, Lord, as he is in desperate need of your healing touch on his body right now. Lord, I pray that you would touch him, that you would clear his lungs of this cancer. Lord, that you would heal his body in the name of Jesus, raise him up. Raise him up, I pray, in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that you would give comfort and peace and reassurance, Lord, to Phil and, Lord, to his wife, Robin, as they walk through this very dark, shadowy valley together, Lord. I just pray. pray for them, lift them up in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen and amen. All right, well, let's worship the Lord. So today, we're going to be looking at testimony of Jesus in John chapter 1. Who Jesus is, not Jesus the man, but Jesus the eternal Word of God. And so this morning I just thought we would honor him specifically in our worship and praise. There's a song called Shout to the Lord, and I just want us to shout in our hearts to the Lord, to praise him this morning, to give him all the glory and all the honor that's due him. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your shelter and that strength. Amen. He's the one who is our strength and our the rock on which we stand, according to the Psalms. Amen. You stood before creation,
What can I say? What can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, worthy to you. I walk upon salvation, your Spirit alive. My life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. And I'll stand my soul,
give you everything this morning. We give you all that we are. Praise your name. We stand before you. We stand upon you, upon your word, Lord, upon your promises. We stand, Lord, upon the salvation that was won for us when you obeyed, or you gave yourself to death, Lord, for us individually, for us as your people. Oh God, thank you so much. That's the testimony on which we stand. Hallelujah. Praise your name. We worship you this morning. We worship you, Lord, this morning. We praise your name.
In the quiet, in the stillness, I know that you are God. In the secret of your presence, I know there I am restored. And when you call, I won't refuse. And each new day again, I'll choose. There is no one else for me, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. There is no one else for me. No, none but Jesus, crucified to set me free. Now I live to bring him praise. The chaos in confusion, I know you're sovereign still. Stillness, I know that you are God.
Thank you, Lord. Praise your name. Praise your name. You know, we need to spend that time with him every day, where we take a time where we're just in the quiet and the stillness with him. You know, he wants that from us. He wants that relationship with us. He wants to encourage you. And there's no better place than in his presence every day, as we rest in him. Amen. We rest in him. It's amazing what he's done for us, and it's something that we cannot forget. We must not forget what he's done for us. Let's sing this last song, "You Are My King," and proclaim that for yourself. Is he your king this morning?
I'm forgiven.
Whoops, sorry, I'm in the wrong key. Okay, here we go.
I'm forgiven, 'cause he was forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. The Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again.
Let's sing that again.
Oh, I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. Oh, I'm forgiven, because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, the Spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, oh, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you
all I do, I honor you. You are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. You are my King. Amazing love. King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you in all I do. I want to honor you. Oh Lord, we just ask that you would help us to do just that. In all that we do, Lord, may we honor you. Hallelujah, Lord. We glorify your name. We glorify your name, Lord. Praise your name. Hallelujah. And everyone said together, amen and amen. You may be seated. You know, as dealing with kids, you know, I was a children's pastor for a while and a bus driver for a while. And so one of the biggest things was, hey, that's not fair. It's not fair. You know how kids are. If they don't get their own way, it's not fair. But if they get something that nobody else gets, well, somehow that's fair. But you know what? Jesus took something and it really wasn't fair. He went to the cross for us. That wasn't fair. I'm accepted because he was condemned. He died for me. That's not fair that the God of all heaven and earth would die for me. And so may we never forget that. Amen? Amen. All right, so in our Bible readings, we have been reading through the Old Testament. We just finished Ezra, Nehemiah, and the building up of the wall and how amazing that was. And now we're in the book of Esther. And of course, if you're familiar with the book of Esther, it's an amazing story of God's redemption and protection of his people. That's the main theme, is that God protected his people from, in normal circumstances, it would have been impossible. They should have been wiped out. But God protected them. And so as a result, every year they celebrate the Feast of Purim. And they celebrate the fact that God protected them from this evil man, Haman. And so I thought maybe we would change up gears. You'll notice that we are going from Esther to John. And you'll notice that there's a few books in between that we're not reading between Esther and John. That was on purpose. It's not a mistake. I wanted to change things up a little bit. My wife was asking me about that too, but I wanted to change it up a little bit. I think we need, I just feel encouraged to get into the New Testament, and so I thought we would go to the book of John, and we're going to spend a little time in the book of John and take a look at our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, because probably most of us, if not all of us in this room, probably claim to be a Christian. And a Christian, of course, is a follower of Jesus Christ. And as a follower of Jesus Christ, we need to know who it is we're following. Amen? We need to know who we're following. And John 1 has always been one of my favorite chapters. And it gives such a wonderful picture of Jesus. Not Jesus the man, that comes later, but Jesus, the eternal one. Jesus, the Word of God. And so we're going to take another look at that and remind ourselves. So John, the author of this book, is often called the disciple that Jesus loved. You You probably heard that, right? The disciple that Jesus loved. And this isn't to say that Jesus loved any of the other disciples less. It's just that there was this special connection between John and his Savior. And it's a connection that I long for in myself, between myself and Jesus. Because remember, John was one of the sons of thunder. He was kind of, impulsive. He and his brother, they wanted to call down lightning to come down and strike people dead. But Jesus kind of mellowed him out over the years. And, of course, we are blessed with the Gospel of John, and we're blessed with John 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, and, of course, the book of Revelation, which was also written by John. So, amazing guy. He was one of the only of the 12 disciples that died of old age. Now, he was technically a martyr because he was martyred, but he survived it. And he was, of course, sent to the island of Patmos to live out his life, and that's where he had this great revelation of Jesus Christ. Well, today we're going to be taking a look at this gospel. And, you know, you'd think, since John is the gospel that Jesus loved, that the theme is love. And love is certainly huge in all of the writings of John. But, you know, this book should consider it about life. It's all about life. It's mentioned over twice as many times in this book than any other New Testament book, life. And so we know that Jesus is the life. And so we're going to be looking at that. You know, testimony is one of the most important tools that we have in order to share the gospel with our world, our testimony. We may bring some information, and somebody might debate that information and say, well, this is not true and because of this and that. But nobody can deny your experience. Excuse me, I'm about to sneeze. I don't want to sneeze into the microphone. Nope, maybe not. Okay. Nobody can deny your experience. Nobody can say, well, you know, Jesus didn't really do that for you. Yes, he did. And there's no way that anyone can deny it, because you know when God has changed your life. And so your testimony is hugely important. And as I said, John 1, beginning of John, is an amazing testimony of Jesus. And I just want us to look at this again this morning. And as Christians, as born-again followers of Jesus Christ this morning, I want us to come away with a fresh understanding of Jesus, maybe an excitement that it's been a while since you felt that excitement for the work of Jesus in your life, through your life. I want us to be excited this morning about this one that we serve. And if there's anyone here who may be watching online or maybe even in this room who are not Christians, I want to encourage you this morning. I pray that you'll be introduced to the Savior this morning, this amazing one that we serve and that we love and that we're excited to serve. So let's take a look at this as we turn to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. We're going to take a look at who is this Jesus? Who is this? Who is this one that we as Christians claim to follow? I mean, it's easy to say, oh, I'm a Christian, I follow Jesus, whatever. Do you follow Jesus or do you follow an idea? Oh, he was a good teacher. He was a loving man. He didn't hurt anyone. And are we following an ideal or are we following Jesus? John begins this gospel with a description that goes beyond the man Jesus, the human Jesus, to the eternal Word of God, which is where Jesus began. He didn't have a beginning, but he was from the beginning. So let's take a look at John chapter 1. I'll just read as we go and comment. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that had been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness could not overcome it. Okay, so let's just pause there. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. From eternity, the Son of God has existed as the Word. This is a deliberate echo, if you remember back to Genesis 1:1. It says, in the beginning, God created. And here this says, in the beginning was the Word. And it talks about Him in creation. It all comes together. It's a beautiful connection between creation in Genesis and recreation through the Son of God. Amen? From sin. And the Greek word here, of course, is logos, logos or logos, logos. You probably have heard that before. In the blue letter Bible, which I like to use in my studies, it kind of breaks down the original languages and everything. This is the note that I found about logos. In John, logos denotes the essential word of God. Jesus Christ, the personal wisdom and power in union with God, His minister in creation and the government of the universe, the cause of all the world's life, both physical and ethical, which for the procurement of man's salvation put on a human nature in the person of Jesus the Messiah, the second person in the Godhead, who shone forth conspicuously from His words and deeds. So that's kind of a scholarly way of bringing the whole logos together here. This is Jesus that we're speaking of. When God created, He simply spoke the words, let there be light, let there be cows, let there be fish. He said, let there be, but then it became different when he created mankind, wasn't it? With His own hands, He created man out of the dust of the earth. And He breathed His life into us as humankind. Jesus was there. Jesus is the Creator. Jesus, the Word of God, was there. He's called the light and the life of all mankind. Jesus identified directly with these ideas of being life and light. In John 6:35, He said, I'm the bread of life. Whoever comes to Me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in Me shall never thirst. So He is our sustenance. And then He said in John 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows Me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. It's talking about the light and darkness. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness would not overcome it. Jesus instructed us as well to be His light. Not that we have light within us, but that we are reflecting this beautiful light that Jesus is. This light is understanding and life, while the dark is the exact opposite of this understanding and life. The light of God's understanding and wisdom overcomes the darkness of this sinful world. John says here that darkness could not overcome it or overpower it or possess it. Darkness could not possess the light. Darkness could not understand the light. The light in and of itself, the light of God's truth, the light that is Jesus Christ. This gospel that guides our lives as followers of Jesus, that changed our lives, should have changed our lives, and that we live out, is the good news of God's love. We each have that message of God's love as God's people. And it's our job to disseminate that. This gospel. Paul said, the message of the cross, which is the gospel, is foolishness to those who are perishing. The world's not going to understand this. The world's not going to, remember it said the darkness could not overcome it, the darkness could not understand it, could not, what is that? Why would a God become a man and die for me? That doesn't make sense, so that can't be right. The darkness, the sinful world, the worldly wisdom can't even grasp this idea. And Paul knew that. He said, for this message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to those of us who are being saved, it's the power of God. It is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. The message of salvation that brings life to those in death is only available through God and cannot be found out with human wisdom. This is the very message that you and I as children of God, carry this is the light of Christ. Amen? And I just think of my friend in Germany, how he, when I mention anything about truth and about how God is the truth and Jesus is the truth, he comes back quickly with, well, you know, everybody's got their own understanding. Everybody's got their own way of living in life. And he doesn't grasp it. He doesn't get it, that Jesus is the only way. And I'm praying for him, and I'm staying in contact with him. Jesus is the Redeemer. Let's continue to read here. So, verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John, and this would be John the Baptist. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, that through him all might believe. That he himself was not the light, he came only as a witness of the light. That's our job as well. The true light that gives light to everyone is coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, even though he was the creator, the world didn't recognize him. He came to that which was his own. He came, was born among the Jews, but they didn't receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. The children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or husband's will, but born of God. You're a child of God if you're born of God, if you're born again. The true light that gives hope, life, hope, understanding, a destination came into the world. This is the anointed one, the Messiah. The Jews were looking for Messiah, but they didn't recognize him when he came. From creation, God had promised his anointed one. Remember, God told Eve, he says, your seed will crush the head of the enemy and he will bruise the heel of your seed. So from the very beginning, the Messiah, the Deliverer, the Redeemer was prophesied. Prophets spoke about him all through the Bible, especially Isaiah. We love Isaiah because from there we see the beautiful, again, incarnation. We see a picture of the incarnation. We love that during Christmas time when we talk about how God would send his Messiah, his special anointed one. The Jews focused only on part of the story. Because, you see, Jesus didn't fit the idea of the Messiah. Oh, this is what the Messiah is supposed to be, and you're not that, so, you know, forget you. Don't we do that today, too? People have an idea of what God should be like. And so anything other than that, they reject. And, you know, my wife and I were talking about this very thing, how people reject. The real sad thing is this. People reject God because of the way that we project him, or the way that we show him sometimes in our sinful way. Maybe they were hurt in a church. And so, you know, oh, God is not, you know, save me from your people, God. I just want you. I just want Jesus. I don't want this, the Bible. I don't want the church. I don't want the people. I just want to know about God. And they have an idea. Well, the Jews were doing the same thing regarding Messiah. He's going to come in. He's going to wipe out the Romans. And everything's going to be hunky-dory. But you know what? That's only a temporary problem. God came for the entire story. Jesus came for the entire story to take care of the real problem, and that would be sin. He did come to rule and to reign, but that was only the second half of the story. They were missing the first half of the story. They wanted a roaring lion, and God sent a lamb. You know, we can't be so involved in our own wisdom and understanding to where we think, well, you know, I don't like this part about God, so I'm going to reject that. I like this about God, that he's love. I don't like that maybe he's a judge, or that he might condemn me because of my sins, or make me feel bad because of my sins. We got to resist that. The Word became flesh. What an amazing verse this is. Verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Isn't this verse just all-compassing? The Word became flesh, the eternal Word. Jesus Christ became flesh, made his dwelling among us, and revealed the glory of God to us through his life. So this Jesus was and is the eternal Word of God, the Son of God, God himself. And now we see John the Baptist again as we look at his own, we'll look at that in just a minute. Let's continue to read verses 15 through 18. John testified concerning him, crying out, "This is the one I spoke about when I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.'" So John the Baptist was the forerunner, the announcer, basically, that Messiah is here. And he said, "This is the one I've been talking about. This one is greater than I. This one was before me. Out of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given, for the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who himself is God and is the closest relationship with the Father, he has made him known." So they had grace and they had God's touch on their life through Moses, through the law. But now, as John is saying here, now Jesus has come to give grace, to give what was not available through the law, but what was promised by the law, certainly promised by the law. So now we look at John the Baptizer's testimony of Jesus. Let's read some more here, verses 19 and following. "Now this, it was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask about who he was." So the priests and Levites were coming, "Hey, John," because this guy was out in the wilderness and he was just acting kind of weird. And so they want to know, "So who are you?" And he didn't fail, John didn't fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." And so they asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Well, who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied, "In the words of Isaiah the prophet, 'I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord.'" Now, the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why is it then that you baptize if you're not the Messiah, if you're not Elijah, and you're not the prophet?" Well, we'll get into that in just a moment. So John begins his testimony about Jesus. He begins his message about Jesus by saying who he's not, John is not. He says, "I'm not the Messiah. I'm the one who's pointing the way to Messiah. Are you Elijah?" "No." Because the Jews knew that Elijah was taken up into heaven. He didn't die. And they believed that he would be back to announce the end times. But John said, "No, I'm not Elijah. That's not my job." Or the prophet. Back in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15, Moses was talking to the people. And he said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your fellow Israelites. You must listen to him." John says, "I'm not that guy either. You're looking for him. I'm not him." It's interesting that they would ask all these things of John, because all of these things are the same answers that Jesus got when he was talking to his disciples. In Matthew 16, it says this, "When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, 'Who do people say that the Son of Man is?' They replied, 'Some say John the Baptist.'" So John the Baptist, "Are you the Messiah?" "No, I'm not the Messiah." And they were saying, "Well, Jesus, are you John the Baptist?" Others say Elijah, and others, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. "But what about you?" he asked. Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Simple testimony. Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood." It didn't come to you through human wisdom, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. You are the rock. And on the rock of your testimony is what he's saying here. On this rock, and the rock being you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Amazing. That was testimony. So John the Baptist is saying, I'm the forerunner, I'm the announcer of this one that you're looking for, this one that you're asking about, this Messiah, Elijah, prophet, who is this one? I'm the announcer of this one, the prophet. Or not the prophet, the Messiah, sorry. John answers the question about who he is, and he mentions, I'm the messenger in the wilderness. He's basically fulfilling Isaiah's prophecy. John explains about his baptism, because they say, well, if you're not these guys, how come you're baptizing? Now, excuse me. One of the things we need to understand, and one of the things I found out, is that the Jews baptized. This isn't just something that started with John the Baptist, but the Jews baptized as well. And baptism that the Jews did was basically for conversion. Any Gentiles who was rejecting their old sinful ways and said, I want to become a Jew, that was one of the things they had to do to become a Jew, was to be baptized. Well, now John was out there, and he was baptizing, but he was baptizing Jews. And they're thinking, you don't baptize Jews, you baptize Gentiles. Well, why are you baptizing? If you're not an authoritative guy like these people, why are you baptizing? And so his baptism was different. His baptism, of course, is the one that we as Christians claim. His baptism was a baptism of repentance. Repentance, we repent from our sins. Like the Gentiles coming into Judaism, they repent of their old lifestyle. That's what we're doing as well. But we're not becoming a Jew. It's we're becoming part of the body of Christ. And then John goes on here, and he said, I baptize with water, John said, but among you stands one whom you do not know. He's the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. What does that mean? Well, to loosen the sandal straps was the job of the lowest servant. And John the Baptist is saying, I'm not even worthy to be the lowest servant when it comes to this man. This man is so great. This one, this Messiah, he is the great one. John testifies in verse 29, the next day John saw Jesus coming toward them and he said, look, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man comes after me who has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. So John uses the image of the sacrificial lamb, which was all throughout the Old Testament. Jesus is the perfect fulfillment of every time that this sacrificial lamb is seen throughout Scripture. The Bible tells us that Jesus was the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Before God even created the world, he knew that a sacrificial lamb had to be made, and Jesus was chosen. He was the animal that was slain in the Garden of Eden to cover up the nakedness of the first sinners. Again, this is symbolic of Jesus, the Lamb of God. He is the Lamb who would himself, when Abraham was going to sacrifice his son Isaac, he was the one that God provided. He was the Passover Lamb. When the Israelites sacrificed the Lamb and put the blood of the Lamb on the doorposts to protect them from death, Jesus is a symbol of that, by his blood that he shed, that we're protected from sin, and we're protected from eternal death from sin. He's the lamb that was the guilt offering in all of the Levitical sacrifices, all the who knows how many, only God knows how many lambs were sacrificed, as a symbol of the coming Lamb of God for sin. He was Isaiah's lamb. Remember Isaiah when he was talking about God's anointed one. He said, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. That was Jesus fulfilled that when he was on trial. He is the Lamb of God, the perfect sacrifice. Each of these lambs that are mentioned in the Old Testament throughout Scripture fulfilled their purpose through their death. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, fulfilled his purpose through his death. This is an announcement that Jesus would have to die and that he would be the sacrifice for the sin of the world. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Did Jesus die for some? Did Jesus die for a few? No, Jesus' sacrifice is enough for everyone. Every single one. His sacrifice for every person. The Bible tells us that God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. You see, Jesus' blood covers every sin of every person, past, present, and future. But that sacrifice can be rejected, unfortunately. And that's what our job is. We're the light. We need to shine that light, that there is payment for sin, that there is an answer. His payment on the cross can be accepted or rejected. We want to see it accepted. Amen. John then recalls his own experience as he goes on, verse 32. John gave this testimony. He said, I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him. But the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man who you see the Spirit come down and remain on is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one. This is the Son of God. So his baptism took place before this particular incident, and as Jesus was coming back, probably to see how John was doing, he was in his travels, John saw him and again said, Behold the Lamb of God. And I remember back when I baptized him. Well, let's take a look at that. Matthew 3 gives us that time when John baptized Jesus. And Jesus came to Galilee. This is Matthew 3:13. Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan and to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him and said, I need to be baptized by you. And you come to me? Jesus replied, Let it be so now. It's proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness. So John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he came up out of the water, and at that moment heaven was open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, This is my Son whom I love, and with him I am well pleased. Wow, what an amazing picture. What an amazing thing. And John here is remembering that, saying, Wow, I was there, and heaven's opened, and the Spirit came down like a dove, and the Father himself spoke and said, This is the one who I'm well pleased. This is my Son. This is my Messiah. So why was Jesus baptized? It's kind of an aside, because I've always, I'm sure that question has come up a lot. Why did Jesus be baptized? He didn't need to be baptized. John's baptism was what? Baptism of repentance. What did Jesus need to repent from? Nothing. So let's take a look at that. First of all, as Jesus himself said in Matthew 3, he said to fulfill all righteousness. This was proper. This is God's plan. So he was baptized to fulfill all righteousness. It symbolized that he was consecrated. What that means is he was made sacred. He was chosen by God for this purpose, and anointed by the Holy Spirit, and testified to vocally by the Father. So it was like a stamp of approval on him. A second reason why Jesus was baptized was that John announced him to be the Messiah at that point. from another place where I was studying called knowingjesus.com. It said this about this instant: the Lord Jesus was the eternal Word. He was the incarnate Word who created all things. And we've learned that from John chapter 1 already. He was the Son of God, the Lamb of God. He was the Anointed One, the King of Israel and Savior of the world. He was the Son of Man, the Word made flesh. And John the Baptist was God's appointed prophet to witness that Jesus is God's only beloved Son, in whom the Father was well pleased. So all that John did was, all the times when he was there preaching, all the times that he was baptizing people for their repentance of their sins, he was proclaiming Jesus, look, the Lamb of God. This is the Messiah. This is the Messiah. A third reason Jesus was baptized was that he completely identified with humanity's sin. Again, he didn't need to be baptized, but he was our substitute. And so just as we need to be baptized to say, hey, I have confessed my sins. I'm a Christian. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ now. Jesus was baptized to show that he was our substitute in this work. And then finally, he was an example to his followers. And as I said, we should be baptized. If you are saved, if you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're born again, then according to his example, we should be baptized in water as well. What is it? Does it wash away sin? No. But it's an example of what God has already done within our hearts, that the sin is gone. The sin is washed away. The sin's paid for. And so we're telling the world by being baptized, just as our Lord has been, as we follow the Lord obediently in baptism, we're telling the world, I identify with him. You know, oftentimes we miss that. People who have been baptized miss that. They do it because, well, I go to this church, so I need to be baptized, or I want to be baptized to be saved, and that's not what baptism is. It's an identification. People can be baptized and then just go on living their life, but I always tell people, I say, listen, you need to be baptized for real, because if not, you're just getting wet and it doesn't do you any good. Baptism, water baptism, is an identification. You're telling the world, I've changed my ways and I am identifying with him. I'm identifying with Jesus Christ. That's what it is. It's very serious. It's as serious as when we take communion. It's serious. Serious business. And that's one of the things I really want us to focus on this morning, is remember the one that we serve. Remember the one that we serve, and we need to be serious about this. We need to serve him with all that we are. Maybe we've been messing around. Maybe we haven't taken him seriously. It's time to change that this morning. And I trust that as you're hearing these words, that you're feeling that encouragement by the Holy Spirit to do just that. So this was the testimony of Jesus, the Word of God, the Eternal One. And then John 1 ends with the first disciples of Jesus. So let's look at verses 35 through 42, first of all, his first few disciples. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. See, John was a teacher, and he had following. Just like any good teacher of the day, they had disciples, people who followed them, wanted to be like them, wanted to learn of them and serve them. And so John had some disciples with him, and he said when they saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. Well, he was just really doing his job, wasn't he? Look, the Lamb of God. There he is. There he is, the Lamb of God. And when the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and said, what do you want? They said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come, he replied, and you will see. So they went, and they saw where he was staying, and they spent the day with him, and it was about 4 p.m. Boy, can you imagine spending the day with Jesus? Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing that Andrew did was to find his brother Simon Peter, And we know that Peter was a big name in the church, in the early church. We have found Messiah. They didn't say, hey, we found this really good guy. We found Messiah, that is the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and he said, you are Simon, the son of John. You will be called Cephas, which means Peter. So these were the first three disciples noted in the book of John, John chapter 1. They heard about Jesus, they had a hunger to know more about him, and they turned from John and they went to Jesus. Wasn't that John's job, though, to point people to the Lamb of God? That's our job as well. Are you a disciple of Jesus Christ? You need to find people and say, hey, I found the Messiah. I found the Messiah. Come with me. Andrew brought his brother Peter to Jesus. The other disciple, so Andrew was one of the disciples of John who started following Jesus. The other one is believed to be John, the author of the Gospel of John. He was the other disciple of John the Baptist who, with Andrew, followed Jesus that day. And then it goes on. There's a couple more people mentioned. Verses 43 and following. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee, finding Philip. He said to him, follow me. Philip, like Andrew and Peter, was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and the one whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph, the Messiah. They knew exactly what he was talking about, the Messiah. Nazareth, can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. Come and see, said Philip. When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said to him, here, truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. How do you know me? Nathanael asked. Jesus answered, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you. Then Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Wow. There's some amazing testimonies at the very outset of following Jesus. Jesus said, you believe me because I told you I saw you under the fig tree. You will see greater things than these. He added, very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. So Philip and Nathanael. Philip was willing. Nathanael was hesitant. Nathanael shows prejudice because from Nazareth, what? Why Nazareth? That's such an out-of-the-way, backwater town. Nothing happens in Nazareth. Nothing good comes. Can anything good come from such an insignificant place? I mean, it wasn't that important. It was very, I would hate to mention the name of a town around us that might be our Nazareth, but boy, it's so insignificant. What could come from there? But Philip didn't argue the point. He didn't start talking to him and trying to convince him. What did he say? He said, come and see. That's all he needed to say. He didn't say, well, you know, from Nazareth, but you know what? There could be something good from Nazareth. Nazareth isn't that bad. I think I've been there. No, he said, come and see. You want to know what good can come from Nazareth? Come and see. And Nathanael was overcome by Philip's invitation? No, by an encounter with Jesus Christ personally. Jesus says, look at you. You are an amazing guy. You're an Israelite from whom there is no deceit. And Nathanael's going, well, how did you know me? Well, I saw you when you were still thinking, when you were resting under the shade of the fig tree. I saw you there. And he had a personal encounter with the Messiah that changed his life. Doesn't this tell you something? Doesn't it tell me something? It's not my amazing words or ability to quote scripture or to show somebody how much I know about Jesus. That's not what's going to win them. It's not winning a debate against an atheist or somebody, you know, proving that there's a God and that Jesus really is. That's not going to win people. What's going to win people is simply me saying, come and see. Come, have an encounter with him yourself. A personal encounter with him yourself. And the Holy Spirit will do the rest. We're disciples like these guys. We need to be like Andrew and say, hey, we found the Messiah. We need to be like Philip and say, come and see. Come and see. We need to bring people to Christ and let the Holy Spirit finish the work. So Christian, I hope that you have a fresh excitement this morning about following Jesus, about living for Jesus, about working for Jesus, looking for opportunities every day, not just living our life, making it through another week so maybe we can go to church on Sunday, but every single day, live for Christ. Live for Christ. Spend time with him every single day. Be recharged every day. Don't wait for Sunday. I mean, we can drag in here and say, oh, it's been a hard week. Whew, I'm just glad I'm in church. I need church today. You could have had church every day. Spend time with him every day. Christian, I want you to be excited. I want you to be re-excited, reignited for Christ. Spend time with him daily. Grow, grow, grow. Look for opportunities to point somebody and say, hey, come and see. Come and see. And if you're not a Christian, if you're within hearing of this message this morning online or wherever you might be, if you're not a Christian, maybe you thought you were, and today you're saying, I don't know if I really was. Maybe I thought I was because I live in America. Maybe I thought I was because grandma was. But you realize that that's not how you become a Christian. That's not how you serve Christ. That's not being born again. I want you to know the fellowship with Jesus Christ that changed Nathaniel's life, that personal encounter. And I want to be like Philip and just simply invite you, come and see. Come and see the Lord. Just come see. See him for yourself. I can't convince you, but you come and see, because I know God can. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word this morning. I'm just excited about this description of you, Lord Jesus. And God, I pray that you would help us to take this message with us as we go. Encourage us. And as I've been praying, Lord Jesus, revive us again. Revive us again. Lord, revive your people. Not for our own benefit, but Lord, so that we can see the kingdom grow. That as we reach out, as we speak your words, as we share the gospel, Lord, may we see your kingdom grow. Oh God, help us to be faithful servants to you. Help us to be faithful disciples to you, Lord Jesus. And God, I pray for those this morning who may not know you. For one reason or another, they just haven't taken that step. I pray, God, this morning that your precious Holy Spirit, the only one that can draw, would speak to their hearts and that they would recognize right now that you're drawing them, that you're tugging at their hearts, that you love them, oh God. You love them deeply, and that you want to save them. Oh Lord God, we don't have much time left. So God, may this just be an amazing and exciting time of history of your church as we look forward to your coming back. Thank you, Lord. Now go with us as we go this morning. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you need prayer for anything this morning, the altars are always open. We'd love to pray with you. But thank you so much for being here this morning and being with us online. And blessings to you and your family. Keep praying for those who need healing. It makes a difference. It really does. And it's not that God won't do anything unless we pray, but he wants us to pray. He wants us to love one another. We don't make God do anything. He's sovereign, but it brings us into his will. Amen? So let's pray. Pray, pray, pray. Amen. God bless you.